Hello, this is Business Time and you're welcome. My name is Kemini. In this episode, we'd have a conversation around the oil and gas industry. We'd ask the question, what benefits have we derived as a people since its inception here in the country, since the discovery to exploration, then to production? What exactly have the benefits been? We'd have this conversation exclusively with the Minister of Energy and Petroleum, Emmanuel Kofi Buah. You want to stay on for that. But first, we'll bring you some of the business stories that made rounds over the week. And then at the end of the program, we'll also bring you a review of commodities and forex activities also over the week, just in case that you miss activities that went down on the commodities and forex market. We'll also give you a pointer into the week ahead. My name is Kemini Amano. You're welcome to the program. It's brought to you in association with Lele Foods and Giant Malt, empowered by the Business and Financial Times newspaper. Don't go away.
After years of serving you with the best in business and financial stories, Business and Financial Times comes to you five times in a week with the introduction of the Thursday edition. Your credible and trusted source of relevant business information will from Monday to Friday, that is five times a week, continue to bring you all the information you need in business, the economy, real estate, maritime, sports and entertainment. Business and Financial Times, Africa's leading provider of credible business information.
Yeah, welcome back to the program. In today's episode, like I said already, we'll have a conversation around the oil and gas sector with the Minister of Energy and Petroleum, Emmanuel Kofi Armah Buah. Now, before this conversation, let's head for the major news that made rounds over the week.
The acting dean of the business school of the Kwame Nkrumah University of Science and Technology, Dr. Ahmed Ejapon, has said one key approach to addressing the country's soaring unemployment situation will be enhancing the capacity of small businesses in order to create more employment opportunities for others. Small businesses, which account for the highest number of registered companies in the country, are considered major contributors to development and growth of the local economy. Trades and Industry Minister Ekosiu Gabra has advised metropolitan, municipal and district assemblies to wake up from their slumbers and engineer innovative mechanisms to explore job creation opportunities in their various jurisdictions. He said it is government's policy for MMDAs to have and promote at least one non-traditional export commodity with competitive advantage for the export market. It is therefore incumbent on assemblies to capitalize on the ecosystem of government interventions such as the Rural Enterprise Program, EDIF, and NBSSI to unlock job opportunities in the agribusiness and microbusiness sectors. The Ghana Interbank Payment and Settlement Systems has, in partnership with EDAPT User Group, launched a new product that will make it possible for international remittances to be transferred directly onto the eSwitch cards. The product is aimed at making it easy for businesses and people living abroad to send money to business associates, friends, and relatives at a relatively cheaper cost and in a convenient manner.
In this week's episode, we'll have a conversation around the oil and gas sector. And we're having this conversation with the Minister for Energy and Petroleum, Emmanuel Armah Kofi Buah, who's joined us here on Business Time. Thank you very much for your time.
It's good to be here.
How have we fared as a country as far as the oil business is concerned, juxtaposing that to events on the world markets over the past few years?
I think the way we know is that the decisions we made when we started, we said that, one, we have to make sure that the oil and gas sector in Ghana will be different, that we will manage oil revenue differently. Now, we said that we should put in systems to ensure that Ghanaians will really participate and be in the forefront of the oil industry. we said that we will have to make sure that this resource adds value to the things we are already doing. And I think that if you want to know how we are doing, you look at all of this. I think we started first thing by making sure that we passed the Petroleum Revenue Management Act to put the people of Ghana at the forefront and set up a public accountability committee. Recently, we did amendment based on lessons learned. But I think all experts around the world really see that that step was very important for Ghana. We have also addressed the other goal we set, which was making sure that Ghanaians are in the forefront of the industry. We have passed the local content regulations that says that Ghanaian personnel, goods, and services must be top priority. We can now say, for example, that almost 7,000 people who are in the oil and gas industry, more than 5,000 are Ghanaians, over 80%. And goods and services are gradually getting there. We are also really moving to ensure that when it comes to gas, which is really very important, we are using gas to really power electricity. And the story here, you have to note, other countries have produced oil for more than 50 years and they are still flaring gas. And so the decision to make sure that we can, as they term it, monetize our gas, bring gas onshore, build a gas infrastructure, and use the lean gas to power thermal plants. And as today I can say, for example, Ghana Gas's production is producing almost half of the country's LPG. That is good achievement. We've not been in the industry for so long, but the steps we've taken, we have not also stopped there. We've also said we need to take steps to send a clear message to the world that this is the best place to invest in the upstream sector. And how are we doing that? We're doing that by making sure that investors are confident that this is a country where transparency, regulations, and the laws are strengthened in a way that promotes investment. And that's why you see, for example, that as we speak, the Exploration and Production Bill has gone through a process and is currently being reviewed by Parliament. When it's passed, you will see that a lot of transparency provisions, a lot of local content provisions, a lot of environmental provisions will be strengthened. And this is progress. And so I think that within the short years, these are the things we can be very proud of. We've done more than even that. What we've also done is that we have also brought the transparency initiative that was in the mining sector to the oil industry. And you see Ghanaians able to, on an annual basis, review line by line how the oil revenue has been spent. This is very important.
Well, now we see crude prices on the world market. It seems to have achieved some sort of stability, but we've seen a tumble over the past few years. What was the effect for Ghana?
It's been terrible in the upstream sector. Layoffs, company folding and leaving. And amazingly, companies are moving headquarters to Ghana. Major projects that have really folded up in a lot of countries. In our case, somehow, the major projects that we all started. You were here, we saw just in the last few weeks when we saw FPSO Mills, almost 6 billion production of Chinebua, Nyenga, and Tommy, one of the second largest production, which in the face of this could have been at risk. It's ongoing. As I speak to you, the subsea infrastructure is now being connected to the FPSO. Hopefully, we will see additional oil production by August this year and see additional gas production next year.
But what one would ask, if oil prices are dropping, why would we want to open those streets?
Well, I think that's a good argument. There's a lot, it's it takes you both sides. Somebody will also tell you this is the best time to probably rent these critical equipments that are so expensive and really do this infrastructure, because those prices have also all tumbled and gone down. So if you want to really invest, this is the time to really do it. But the story about Ghana's, you know, in this period of distress, where so many companies in so many countries, is amazing. Because as we speak, in the next few weeks, you will see that a major tech development, the Sankofa project, will also start. And it tells us something. What it says is that I think the investor community, if you look at the negotiations on the Sankofa, the OCT project, and you look at critical world institutions like the World Bank and IFC coming to support and invest for that project to be possible, it speaks volumes about the confidence of this country's economy and the leadership that has been provided by President Mahama in the upstream sector. Mm. And it is not for nothing that is happening. It's happening because, for example, investors are seeing that critical regulations are being passed, that a call, for example, for us to look at PNDC Law 84, which has served us for so long, and make sure we can really implement modern things in it has been done. It's the site in time. But more importantly, we have entered a gas era. And that is what the story really is. For all the excitement about oil, I think history will recall that Ghana is blessed because our upstream sector has ushered in a period of gas production that will help to produce more electricity for our people and give us other liquids that will help our country.
We'll come back and then we'll have the second half of the conversation. Hopefully, we'll look at the shortages that we've seen in the past and how government is fixed the problem so that hopefully in the future we don't see that. We're speaking with the Minister of Energy and Petroleum, Emmanuel Kofi Armah Buah, and we'll have the second part of the conversation right after the break. Don't go away. You're welcome back to Business Time. My name is Kemini Amano. In this episode, we started a discussion with the Minister of Energy and Petroleum, Emmanuel Kofi Armah Buah. In case you just joined us, you may have missed the bulk of the conversation, but this is a part that you may find equally interesting, where we ask, in the future, would we see any shortages when it comes to
petroleum products?
Petroleum products, indeed. Is that something that we should look forward to?
Well, I think that we've come a long way. If you think about it, the simple business of importing petroleum products and just selling it, and it was a business that got government so involved that led to so much losses, that led to government indebtedness. And I think this is what history will record of President Mahama's achievement. If you look at BOST, for example, BOST, what BOST does, BOST has storage facilities. And basically, private companies will come and keep products in the BOS facilities. Guess what? Over the years, it led to so much losses. Because if I put 2 gallons, the next time I come, it's 1 gallon and a whole lot of things. And then in the end, it's losses. And government says, you know what? This simple business of really looking at this, we're going to bring the private sector in there and let them take the risk of those losses. And guess what? Losses are gone. And the burden on the ordinary Ghanaian is gone. And that's why you see BOS being vibrant. Again, government makes a big policy decision and says, you know what? Government tax should be simply that people, that the National Petroleum Authority is ensuring that the licensing requirements are followed, that safety is followed, that people are products are of good quality.
But a simple business of buying the product and selling it should be something that must be determined in the market. And already through this deregulation policy, we see competition, we see quality product service provision, and we see even reduction of prices and keen competition to the benefit of the ordinary Ghanaian. This is what has happened. And we believe as we move along, you will see. You know, just last week we launched another major company player in the downstream sector, Puma, coming to join the league of Shell and Total and Goyal. Already Goyal has been amazingly revived and rebranded, and now facing the competition, you see Puma also coming in. I think that the industry is now set to provide more products, and we think that we won't see product shortages.
Maybe they're coming because business is good for them, but not necessarily for the end user. So that even after we were slapped with the energy,
still out.
The
I
energy
think the jury
levy.
Is out. I think, as we've said, the reason, for example, that we make sure we are still subsidizing critical products like premise, marine gas oil and others is that we are saying that we are watching the system to make sure that the ordinary Ghanaian is always not at a disadvantage. And at any time, government is keeping its eye to make sure that people are playing fair and that the competition is to the advantage of the ordinary Ghanaian.
Mm. How well has the energy levy that...
That's a very good one.
How well has it done since...
First, let me say that this is one very difficult decision. And I have to tell you that if somebody asks me, how do you think about President John Dramani Mahama? I will tell you, see that through the tough decision that this president makes. And this decision was made after a sober reflection of the people of Ghana's difficulties gone through. And the question was asked, do we go through all this crisis and go back again? Or do we take the fundamental decisions that will usher Ghana into an era where the power sector that has historically been embedded with so much indebtedness is cleared as we enter a gas era, where clearly IPPs or independent power producers will come and allow the electricity to really grow? Demand for electricity is growing. I've already said that we are now in an era where thermal power, and now we are producing indigenous gas. What has been preventing us from really adding power over the years has been this challenge. And I believe this levy is something that has been a difficult decision, but a decision that will ultimately allow us to produce electricity and produce more gas to ensure that the critical constraint to our economy, which is electricity production, will be there for industries and job creation in the coming years.
So we're seeing some yield. Now, besides that also, I remember before we expanded what used to be into the energy levy, we had something that was going into the revamping of TOR.
Yes.
Yes, and now we hear that TOR has been able to manage its problems.
We are working with TOR closely to make sure that the critical things that need to be done. The critical problems of TOR has to do with how do we make sure that the plant that was built by Sajifo, that the plant is revamped, and that the equipment that are needed to make sure that these huge losses are gone and that the plant will produce and will be competitive is happening. I think we continue to support TOR to get to that level. And I'm very happy about the focus and the progress we are making at all.
For some people, I mean, when we started production as a country, we were told that TOR couldn't refine the crude we were producing from our sites. Recently, we started hearing something different. So what exactly is the situation?
TOR can produce. If you listen to me earlier, we were making a lot of decisions about what are the priorities. We're trying to make an arrangement to make sure we can build a gas processing plant. Mm-hmm. We needed to get money to do that. We had to engage the Chinese to do that with the same 12% of our oil, the oil that was being produced, I told you about. And so I think we have made some decisions earlier. We believe we are getting to a point where we will be able to comfortably get the oil being produced here in Ghana for tall. But we want to do that in a way that ensures that we don't lose. We want to do that it is profitable for the country and for tall. And we are going to get there.
How soon do you think that future
very,
is?
Very soon. Very soon.
Very soon. Very soon. Like, we look forward to that. I think it would be great to have us refine our own crude and use here in the country.
Yes.
And, I can't wait for that future.
Yes.
But there's something else I want to talk about. The situation with Atwabo.
Yes.
And the maintenance over there, which cut supply to some of our plants. Now, I don't want to talk about the electricity production side of it. Of course, it's no longer under your ministry. But I want us to talk about the process itself that causes the equipment to go offline. What exactly is this maintenance that always deprives us of our gas?
Well, that's a very important point. I think this time we know what the problem is. The problem is that it is coming from the offshore, 60 kilometers offshore, the gas processing plant at the Jubilee Field. The Tarek is what holds the FPSO, and something called a beam that holds it is damaged. And so we now have to get what they call a tugboat to hold it into stability. They are doing the root cause analysis to understand what has really happened. We still don't have that work. It's very extensive. I visited the FPSO, and it's a lot of work to try to get to the bottom of that. But in the meantime, they are working on the clock to try to make sure we can offtake the oil that is in the FPSO so that production can resume. And that is taking a while because there's a lot of safety precautions that need to be taken before oil is transferred into a shuttle tanker that will be transferred to another tanker that is standing about 10 kilometers away. Mm. All of that is happening. I think that is the reason why we are not able to evacuate gas to the Atwabo plant.
Mm.
But that really tells you the challenges that we've talked about.
Mm.
We believe that we have to work to have alternatives. As you speak, we are talking about building an LNG because to be able to really transport gas from long distances so that when we have challenges here, we don't really suffer. I know that we will overcome this challenge.
Mm.
We are working on the clock.
When do they tell you that we can deal with the current challenges as they are?
No, I've been on the FPSO. Mm. I have the whole Talo and their team coming to answer questions I have on where we are. We are working on the clock to address it because this implication is huge for the country. So we want them to finish like yesterday, but we are also very cautious of the safety implications.
Absolutely.
And that's why we spend time there. And so what I've said is simple. Give us the gas as quickly as possible. We need it. But we are not doing that at the peril of our environment, safety, or the huge investment we've made. After all, the oil is there and it's for us. So we are working on the clock to make sure we can address the problem. But I can tell you it's a serious challenge, and it is like any other machine, like a car, your crankshaft just boom is gone and you need to fix it. Fix it right so that you don't come back to it. Okay. I think that it is being fixed. But we are going to make sure that we do everything it takes as we speak. Just had an engagement where we have our own government engineers to not only verify what they are telling us, but to check and make sure that things are done right and quickly.
What will be your final words?
Well, thanks for the opportunity to chat with you. And I think it's been lovely business times. And I encourage Ghanaians to keep watching business times.
Absolutely. You heard him. He's encouraging you to watch the program all the time. Well, thank you very much for
coming. Thank you. It's good to be here.
Well, so I hope that you've picked your pointers from the conversation we've been having with the Minister of Energy and Petroleum on the oil and gas sector. Most importantly, he's told us that the situation with the turbo gas is being dealt with. How soon? Well, we don't know for sure, but he says very soon. We look forward to that. It's time now for us to check activities on the commodities and forex market that took place over the week. Don't go away.
Suavemente, bésame, que quiero sentir tus labios besándome otra vez.
Suave,
bésame, bésame,
suave,
bésame otra vez.
Suave,
yo quiero sentir tus labios
suave,
besándome otra vez.
Giant Mold is a non-alcoholic beverage which contains minerals and vitamins that gives you energy and power to keep you moving. Giant Mold brings out the giant in you.
After years of serving you with the best in business and financial stories, Business and Financial Times comes to you 5 times in a week with the introduction of the Thursday edition. Your credible and trusted source of relevant business information will from Monday to Friday, that is 5 times a week, continue to bring you all the information you need in business, the economy, real estate, maritime, sports and entertainment. Business and Financial Times, Africa's leading provider of credible business information.
So there you have it. Those were the activities that took place on the commodities and forex markets. I hope you've taken down your pointers for the week ahead. But that's it for our program this week. It was brought to you in association with Lily Foods and Giant Malt. My makeup is by Jubin House of Beauty. You find Jubin House of Beauty in the heart of Tessano, 2 blocks opposite the police depot. And you can get beautiful just as I am looking right now. My name is Kemini Amano. My costume is by June Berry. Thank you very much for staying with us in this week's episode. We'll see you same time next week. Goodbye.